Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Chaitali Parekh, consultant musculoskeletal interventional radiologist. After the amazing video on the MRI anatomy of the rotator cuff, today we will be discussing MRI in rotator cuff tendinosis and tear and how to create a report that is surgically relevant. Hope you enjoy the video. This is a proton density sagittal image of the shoulder showing the four rotator cuff muscles. This is the glenoid with the coracoid process and this is the spine of the scapula. So this is anterior and this is posterior. Now between the coracoid process and the spine of the scapula is the supraspinatus fossa, which contains the supraspinatus muscle. Anteriorly you have the subscapularis muscle. Posteriorly there are two muscles. The superior one is infraspinatus and the inferior one is teres minor muscle. Now when you come laterally, you start to see the humeral head with the rotator cuff tendons around the humeral head. And this is what the tendons look like. So approximately at 12 o'clock position, you have the supraspinatus tendon and the conjoint tendon. Anteriorly is the subscapularis tendon. Anterosuperiorly is the biceps tendon, which is abutting the humeral head. Posterosuperiorly is the infraspinatus tendon and posterior inferiorly is the teres minor tendon. Now one important thing to note is that subscapularis is a multipinnate tendon, that is it has multiple tendons and functionally it is not a single tendon. Rather, functionally it consists of two parts, that is the superior subscapularis and the inferior subscapularis. Now on the sagittal image you can see all the rotator cuff tendons. Besides that, on the coronal image, the supraspinatus tendon is very well visualized, which is seen attaching to the greater tuberosity of the humerus. Whereas on the axial images, you can see the subscapularis and the infraspinatus tendons. So anteriorly, you can see the entire length of the subscapularis tendon with the biceps tendon in the bicipital groove. Posteriorly, you can see the entire infraspinatus tendon. Now one thing to keep in mind is, please have the arm of the patient in the neutral or slightly externally rotated position while performing the scan. Please do not keep the arm in internally rotated position, because when you do so, it is very difficult to assess the subscapularis and the anterior supraspinatus tendons. It is important to know the parts of the tendon because you need to put them in the report while describing a tear. So in the supraspinatus tendon, this is the footprint or the enthesis, that is the point where the tendon attaches to the bone. This is the critical zone of the tendon, which is approximately 1 to 1.5 centimeter from the enthesis, and it is particularly seen and important in the supraspinatus tendon. It was hypothesized that the critical zone is hypovascular and prone for degenerative tears. However, with recent research, the hypovascularity of the critical zone is a topic of debate. Nevertheless, it is one of the common sites for the supraspinatus tendon tear. And the third one is the myotendinous junction. Usually, traumatic tears happen at the myotendinous junction. Now, we'll discuss the pathogenesis behind tendinosis and tear and what are their MRI appearances. So this is the humeral head with the supraspinatus tendon attaching to it. Now we'll concentrate only on the tendon. So tendon is made up of collagen fibers as depicted by these orange line in the graphic presentation. Between the collagen fibers are water molecules, which are nothing but these white colored rounded structures. Normally the water molecules are so tightly bound that they cannot move around, and hence it appears jet black on the MRI image. In case of tendinosis, there is disorientation and degeneration of the collagen fibers, and as a result of which there is some movement of the water molecules, but they still cannot move freely. In case of a tear, there is disruption of the collagen fibers, and now the water molecules are free to move around. So this is a normal MRI tendon which appears jet black in color. This is a tendon which shows tendinosis, so there is some hyperintense signal within the tendon, but it is not as bright as the adjoining bursal fluid the subacromial bursal fluid. And in case of tear, you can see that the signal is as bright as the adjoining subacromial bursal fluid. Now, whenever you are assessing rotator cuff tendons, first thing you need to decide whether there is tendinosis or tear. In case of tears, you need to know whether it is a partial thickness tear or a full thickness tear. The partial thickness tears can further be divided into articular-sided, interstitial and bursal-sided tears. Now, we'll look at each of these individually. So, whenever there is tendinosis, you need to grade it as mild, moderate or severe. So, this patient has mild tendinosis. As you can see, there is some hyperintense signal within the tendon. While this patient has moderate tendinosis, where there is increased length of the tendon involved and the signal is brighter as compared to this patient. And this patient has severe tendinosis, where the signal is further brighter. But point to note is that the hyperintense signal within the tendon is still not as bright as the fluid in the adjoining subacromial bursa, which means that this is tendinosis and not a tear. In tendinosis, there is accumulation of mucoid material within the tendon, and sometimes this can track along the path of least resistance, as in this case it is tracking up to the myotendinous junction with formation of intratendinous cystic change. Similarly, this patient has subscapularis tendinosis with formation of a ganglion cyst towards the myotendinous junction. Now, just like the mucoid material can track towards the myotendinous junction, similarly, it can also enter into the bone with formation of intraosseous cystic changes. Now, intraosseous cystic changes can be as tiny as these, or they can be as large as this one. It is important to mention the location and size of the intraosseous cystic change, because the arthroscopic repair of a rotator cuff tendon involves placing of an anchor in the humeral head. There are sutures that come out of this anchor, and these sutures are then tied to the torn tendon and the tendon is fixed back to the bone. Now, if the anchor is placed in the intraosseous cystic area, like in this case, the anchor will not be held firmly in the bone, and as soon as the patient uses the arm, the anchor will come out and result into tendon re-tear. This is another patient who had a large but multiloculated intraosseous cystic change. Along with that, there was a tiny ganglion cyst at the myotendinous junction. Now, sometimes the tendinosis is not just because of degeneration, but there is presence of calcification, and this is nothing but calcific tendinosis. Now, you can see this hypo-intense structure. So, calcium appears hypo-intense on all the sequences. So, there is calcium at the enthesis of the supraspinatus tendon. It is also extending into the subacromial bursa, resulting into the inflammation of the bursa. And you can see that the bursal lining is thickened with fluid in the bursa. And along with that, there is deltoid edema. So, actually, this is a case of acute exacerbation of calcific tendinosis, or rather, calcific tendinitis. These patients will come to you with a classical history of sudden onset acute pain. Now we'll discuss about partial thickness tears. So it can be articular sided, interstitial or bursal sided. We'll look at each of these. So in articular sided tear, this is what is a articular sided tear. So you can see that there is tear along the articular surface of the tendon, but the bursal surface of the tendon is intact. Now, it is also called as pasta. Do you think there is any correlation with the yummy Italian pasta recipe? No, unfortunately not. It just stands for partial articular surface tendon avulsion. So, this patient, first of all, you don't have to mention the term pasta in your report. What is more important is to describe the tear. So, how are you going to describe this tear? So, this patient has an approximately 75% thickness, partial, articular-sided tear at the supraspinatus enthesis. So this is how you'll describe the tear. If you'll see, there are some bursal fibers which are intact in this patient. And this is what the tear appears on a sagittal image, and this is the anterior-posterior dimension. Now, Similarly, you have bursal-sided tears where the articular surface is intact. Now, they could not put up a fancy name for this, so they decided to call it antipasta. So, this is approximately 75% thickness bursal-sided tear where you can see that the articular surface or the articular fibers are intact to some extent and there is fluid in the adjoining subacromial bursa. Now, in case of interstitial tear, there is tear within the substance of the tendon. The articular surface and the bursal surface are intact. Now, these tears are present in the substance of the tendon with obviously intact articular and bursal surfaces, and as a result, they cannot be picked up by an orthopedic surgeon on arthroscopy. Because these tears play hide and seek with the orthopedic surgeon, it is very important for us radiologists to report these tears. So here, you can see the bursal surface of the tendon is intact, the articular surface of the tendon is intact, but there is a linear hyperintense signal within the tendon. And if you'll appreciate, the signal of this particular linear hyperintensity is same or is as bright as the adjoining fluid in the subacromial bursa. So this is nothing but a long interstitial tear in the supraspinatus tendon. Now, one more important tear is a rim rent tear, which are small partial thickness articular sided tears or pasta. And these tears are commonly found in the anterior most fibers of the supraspinatus tendon. Now, this is one of the common site for a partial thickness tear to begin in case of a supraspinatus tendon. And if missed, these tears can progress into large partial thickness tears or even a full thickness tear. So this is a rim rent tear, and this is the entire biceps tendon, and on the coronal image just next to the biceps tendon you can find the anterior most fibers of the supraspinatus tendon. However, many a times it is difficult to pick up these tears on coronal images, and therefore it is very important to keep an eye for these tears on sagittal images, where you can see the subscapularis tendon, the biceps tendon, and just next to the biceps tendon you can see the tear. So this is the rim rent tear. Now we'll discuss full thickness tears. So this patient, if you'll see, the enthesis is intact, but there is a full thickness tear in the critical zone of the supraspinatus tendon, and the tear is not much retracted. This is the anteroposterior dimension of the tear on the sagittal image. Against this patient has a full thickness tear from the enthesis, and the tendon is almost retracted up to the glenohumeral joint. And when you see on the sagittal image, you can see that the entire supraspinatus and infraspinatus tendon is not visualized. What you can see is the teres minor tendon. So now it is important to mention the anteroposterior dimension of the tear, which is this much in this particular case. Whereas in this case, the anteroposterior dimension is a long one. Okay, so it is a sum of these two lengths. Now, it is important to give these anteroposterior dimension to the orthopedic surgeons, because when the tear is small, as in this case, the repair is done with usually one or two anchors. But when the tear is large, the surgeon will require more anchors. So he may actually use three anchors to repair these tears. So, if the surgeon knows the anteroposterior dimension before the surgery, he can accordingly prepare for the surgery. And also just remember, more the anchors, more is the costing of the surgery, and so accordingly, he can also inform the patients. Now, next is to mention the exact retraction of the tone tendon in centimeters from the enthesis, and also the level to which the tone tendon is retracted. Now, what do I mean by the level? So first, let me just tell you how to measure the retraction of the tendon in centimeters. So you just take from the greater tuberosity and you go up to the retracted tendon margin. So this is what is the retraction in terms of centimeters. And by level, I mean this tendon is retracted up to the mid-humeral head level. This is retracted up to the glenohumeral joint line. And this is retracted nearly medial to the glenoid. Next is a full thickness delaminating tear. Now it is important to identify these tears. Delaminating tear is nothing but a horizontal air that divides or that is present within the tendon substance that will divide the tendon into superficial and deep fibers, or as in this case, bursal and articular fibers. So you have to identify these tears and also mention the retraction of each of the fibers. So this is what the superficial fibers is retracted up to, whereas the deeper fibers are retracted further medially. It is important to mention the presence of the delaminating tear as well as the level to which the superficial and deep fibers have been retracted, because if the orthopod is not aware that the deeper fibers have been retracted further medially, he will land up repairing only the superficial fibers. And in fact, most of the strength of the supraspinatus comes from the deeper fibers. So eventually, when the patient will start using his arm, there are high chances that he will develop a re-tear in the repaired tendon. Now, this is a full thickness myotendinous junction tear, as you can see over here. And these tears are usually, they tend to be traumatic. Now, we'll discuss subscapularis tears. There are some things in subscapularis tears which are different as compared to a supraspinatus or an infraspinatus tear. So this is a normal subscapularis tendon which goes and attaches to the lesser tuberosity. This is the biceps tendon in the bicipital groove. Now there is a school of thought which says that one of the tendon slip from the superior subscapularis tendon goes underneath or deep to the biceps tendon in the bicipital groove and attaches to the greater tuberosity. Now this provides medial stability to the biceps tendon and prevents its medial dislocation or subluxation. So whenever there is a tear of the superior subscapularis tendon, the biceps tendon tends to dislocate medially towards the glenohumeral joint. So in this patient, if you see, the bicipital groove is empty. In fact, the tendon is dislocated medially close to the glenohumeral joint. And what you notice is there is a full thickness subscapularis tear. Now, this doesn't mean that all patients with a subscapularis tear will have a dislocated biceps tendon. As in this case, you can see that the patient has intact superficial fibers, but the deep fibers are torn. Yet, the biceps tendon is not dislocated medially. Instead, it is just mildly subluxed. In fact, it is perched on the medial lip of the bicipital groove. Just keep in mind that mild medial subluxation of the biceps tendon can also occur with moderate to severe subscapularis tendinosis. Now, this is an interstitial subscapularis tear, and here you can see that this is a delaminating subscapularis tear where the biceps tendon is actually dislocating in the substance of the subscapularis tendon. Next point to report is the muscle atrophy, which is decided by the line joining the coracoid process to the spine of the scapula for the supraspinatus muscle and line joining the spine of the scapula to the inferior tip of the scapula for the infraspinatus muscle. So in case of a normal muscle, you can see that the muscle extends above this line. In case of mild atrophy, the muscle extends up to the line. In case of moderate atrophy, the upper margin of the muscle is below the line. And in case of severe atrophy, the muscle is actually situated in a corner of the supraspinatus fossa. Now, next important thing to mention is fatty infiltration of the muscles, which is classically graded as per the Gotelier's classification. So again, we look at the supraspinatus muscle and there is no fat. So this is grade 0 or normal. Few fatty streaks indicate grade 1. More fat as compared to grade 1, but the fat is still less than the muscle, that's grade 2. The amount of fat and the amount of muscle is equal, that's grade 3. And the fat is more than the muscle, that is grade 4. Fatty infiltration and muscle atrophies are important prognostic indicators, with fatty infiltration being a more important prognostic indicator, because following arthroscopic repair, the muscle bulk and strength can be increased with postoperative rehabilitation and physiotherapy. However, fatty infiltration is usually irreversible. So patients with higher grades of fatty infiltration have poor prognosis, as in these two cases, and they need longer periods of postoperative rehabilitation. Sometimes, besides the rotator cuff tear, biceps tendinosis can be a cause of pain. So whenever you're reporting a patient with rotator cuff tear, you need to mention the status of the biceps tendon as well, because if it is tendinosed, the surgeon prefers to do a tenotomy or a tenodesis of the biceps tendon. So this is a normal biceps tendon. Here there is intrasubstance split, and this tendon shows moderate to severe tendinosis. Again, you can see that the intraarticular biceps tendon shows moderate to severe tendinosis. Now, what are massive tears? By definition, it involves two or more tendons and it is more than 5 cm in any dimension. But there are other criteria as well which are considered by the orthopedic surgeons, which include marked muscle atrophy, grade 3 or 4 fatty infiltration, severe mediolateral retraction, which is either up to or medial to the glenohumeral joint line, reduced acromio-humeral distance, that is distance between the acromion and humerus. Normally it is 7 to 14 mm. Whenever it is equal to or less than 6 mm, it is reduced. There is no fixed protocol for the treatment of massive tears. Some orthopods offer to operate on these tears, some do not, depending upon the clinical symptoms and the presence and absence of muscle atrophy and fatty infiltration. However, it is important to mention all these points in the report, because massive tears are usually associated with poorer prognosis. Now, the last topic to discuss is rotator cuff arthropathy, which occurs in massive rotator cuff tears. There is superior humeral head migration, as a result of which there is reduced acromio-humeral distance. This usually occurs because following massive rotator cuff tear, there is unopposed action of the deltoid on the humerus, which causes the superior humeral head migration. There are degenerative changes in the superior aspect of the glenohumeral joint, and there is femoralization of the humeral head and acetabularization of the undersurface of acromion. So now let's look at each of these findings. So this is a normal supraspinatus tendon with a normal acromio-humeral distance, which is 8.3 millimeters. In this patient, there is reduced acromio-humeral distance, which is 5.1 millimeter. Plus, as you can see, you can identify the greater tuberosity very nicely in the normal patient, whereas here there is flattening of the greater tuberosity, which is called as femoralization of the humeral head, and also there is pseudo-articular surface formation on the undersurface of acromion. This is known as acetabularization of the acromion. And in this patient, besides reduced acromio-humeral distance, also there is chondral loss in the superior humeral head and superior glenoid. The inferior cartilage is still well seen. So patients who develop osteoarthrosis secondary to massive rotator cuff tear, they can undergo reverse shoulder arthroplasty as a treatment. Now, confused what to report? We have discussed a lot many things. Okay, so now let's make things simpler. So whenever you do an MRI for rotator cuff tendons, you need to look whether there is tendinosis or tear. In case of tendinosis, see if it is mild, moderate or severe. In case of tear, you need to see if it's a partial thickness tear or a full thickness tear. In case of partial thickness tear, you have to mention the percentage of the thickness or the percentage thickness of the tendon that is torn. And you need to mention whether the partial thickness tear is articular sided, bursal sided or interstitial. And this is the checklist for the reporting of a tear. So you need to mention all these points while describing a tear.
Hi, hope you've liked the video. I hope this reporting pattern and lexicon helps you to make appropriate reports in your day-to-day practice. If you have any queries regarding this topic, you can type them in the comment section below and we will get back to you. Stay tuned for more such knowledge-packed videos. Thank you.